Fire in the hole!
Hurt Locker follows three EOD techs, three explosive ordnance disposal technicians in the U.S. Army as they make their way through the last month and a half of their tour.
What really separates this particular conflict, I think, from conflicts in the past is the predominance of IEDs, or roadside bombs. That's really the signature of this particular conflict, and the hope is to be able to replicate the feel of war, the kind of chaos of war, the messiness of war.
I think the thing about the script that really got me is you really got a sense of this world that is so completely unpredictable and completely dangerous, and it doesn't care who anybody is, anybody can go at any time. And at the same time, there's a real surreal quality to it. And I think that's just a great combination that really, really says what that experience in Iraq is about.
Guys, make room.
I spent some time embedded with an Army EOD unit in Iraq and going out on missions with them and living with them and just sort of living life as they live it.
I realized, as Mark was telling me about the EOD team, that they probably had the most dangerous job in the world.
Tell him to open his shirt slowly. I need to see what's inside. Slowly. Jesus. All right, Sergeant, I need 75 meter perimeter. Get these guys back. Get them back.
Get back!
I remember putting down the script.
Usually I just put it down. I can't think twice about it, but this one I wrote like 3.5 pages of just ideas and questions and answers and, I was just really captivated by the character and the story.
This is suicide, man.
That's what they call a suicide bomb, right? Let's do this. Come on.
The way in which the script was written and the way in which it sort of delves into human psychology, I suppose, I found really fascinating. I think, you know, Mark and Catherine have both done a beautiful job of capturing and sort of realizing these characters.
That blast is going to roll straight out there. The shell will probably kick out there. Most of the shrapnel is going to shoot straight up in a beautiful umbrella pattern.
Yeah.
We're going to get some smaller pieces and shell fragments this way, but we'll be okay if we're behind the Humvee.
Working with Catherine has been a life-altering experience.
You know, she's an action director, and like, you know, she paints with the cameras.
I feel like Catherine has a knack for getting really good performances out of actors.
She's got a really, like, easy way about her, and I think that's always important for an actor, because the more comfortable you feel, the you know, the bigger risks, the more exposed, you know, you want to put yourself in.
It's been great having somebody with that much experience and that great sense of visual style and story and character. She's one of the great independent filmmakers.
So we have this EOD team, this Explosive Ordnance Disposal team, comprised of three very discrete characters, James, Sanborn, and Eldridge, Jeremy Renner, Anthony Mackey, and Brian Garrity.
Sergeant James, in particular, is a soldier who is addicted, almost, to combat.
He's attracted to the kind of adrenaline the combat provides. But at the same time, he's extraordinary in his ability.
He's got an interesting sort of take on fear.
He's kind of a man of few words and a lot of action. He kind of gets things done. He doesn't really talk about it. got more wire. It's fucking no drawer. Fuck!
Hey, James, how you doing?
I'm wonderful. How are you?
You know, we've been here a while. We need to get out of here soon.
Uh-huh.
We got a lot of eyes on us, James. We need to get out of here.
Roger that. I'm gonna figure this out.
James, we need to get out of here. James, do you copy?
I get it.
Sanborn is somebody who has had a lot of military experience. He's more the everyman. He's there to get his job done.
He's very strong. He's very steady. And he kind of navigates in a very sort of rational way through all this chaos.
I felt like there was this depth with him and this machismo that comes along with a lot of, you know, soldiers, American men, where they aren't allowed to express their emotions till it's too late and they just overwhelm and boil out.
Hey, James.
Yeah.
Never turn your headset off again.
Eldridge is the character who is the youngest, the most impressionable.
He's looking to Sanborn and he's looking to James for some guidance. And at the same time, on a deeper level, he's looking to see which of those two older, more experienced men hold the answer for how to survive.
You see the impression the other team members make upon him, and as he begins to grow and change and transform and begin to reflect either Sanborn or James.
He's a cross between Sanborn and James. He's have moments of strength. He's a funny guy. I think he's their, I always thought of him as their support system.
Hey, Sanborn. You know what this place needs?
I'm listening.
Needs grass.
We're gonna start our grass business?
That's right, man. I'm gonna sell the grass, and you're gonna cut it. It's gonna be called Sanborn and Sons. We'll be rich.
Working with Anthony and Garrity has been an absolute treat because they make my jobs easy.
I feel like this movie dealt with the characters in depth and everything that they went through and are going through in the war, trying to make it home.
We found this extraordinary cinematographer, Barry Ackrind, whose style and ability to create a documentary feel out of fictional material is probably peerless. He puts you right in the front seat. He puts you in the film.
Well, I think the interesting thing is what can you do with the camera that can make you feel like you're a participant? You can put yourself in the middle of the scene, or you can, more correctly, you put yourself right on the edge of the scene and participate in what goes on.
We had four discrete units and I would place them around the 360 degree set. So literally there was no place you could turn that you wouldn't see a camera.
We got cameras everywhere. We call them ninja cameras. They're just hiding all over the place. We never know where anything is. It freaks me out sometimes, but I'm definitely looked in camera like this. Oh, there's a camera all the time.
With this camera, we can shoot up to 50,000 frames per second. So it's like shooting 1,000 image per second.
Catherine wants to make sure that the shock wave that is generated from real explosions shows through on this. Gives a sense of power and reality to it.
Trying to replicate that was really important.
Nobody is any closer than the corner of this building.
In an attempt to make this look real, I'm trying to make it real.
The best thing about shooting in the Middle East that's helped me to develop this character is just the heat.
I think the experience here has been physically pretty demanding.
Just sand, wind, heat, sun. There was something incredibly immediate about shooting it in an environment that was unforgivably hot.
I think all of that added to just, you know, compounding these characters to make them more three-dimensional.
That sweat's real sweat. Those tears are real tears of pain.
I think there has to be a kind of superhero aspect to soldiers going into war, because if you wake up every day in fear, you'll drive yourself crazy because you realize every minute is possibly your last.
Go! Go! Everybody get back!
Go, go, go!
Hang on!
Get a script or a job that feels important to you, and you're a lucky person. There's Kyle Pierce, Ray Fiennes, David Morse.
I mean, you know, the script is smart.
The other guys that I'm working with are fantastic.
I'll look back and this is the most spectacular experience that I've probably done as a man, even as an actor.
My intention was to put the audience into the soldier's shoes, into the Humvee. Almost ask them to be the fourth man on the team and have them experience what those soldiers experience. What it's like to walk down on a bomb, how the world begins to recede. It's an epic walk. That's where the film lives. And if you can put the audience there and give them that walk, then I suppose as a filmmaker I've done everything I could imagine doing.
Thank you.